to you all this morning. We're going to take our lesson today on a kind of a strange subject, I think. At least maybe the timing is a little odd because it's September and we're going to talk about demons. More of an October kind of thing, at least in my mind, but we're going to talk about it in September anyway. It came up in Bible class a couple of weeks ago, and something I kind of studied a little bit further on, and found some study I'd done in the past as well, and so I'd like to try to present that this morning. We're going to spend a good bit of time, obviously, in the book of James today, and so you might open there. We'll get there in a little while. We're not headed there right away, but James is a controversial book in the New Testament. It's a controversy because really just a reading of it that's on the surface would invalidate the Calvinist theory of salvation by faith or grace alone, because it includes the idea of human effort in the equation that results in justification. The concept that there's something that believers need to do in relation to their own salvation. And so it comes down to a problem that has been around for hundreds of years in Bible students, and that is either James is contradicting things we know Paul wrote, or there's really a complementary nature between the two letters. And of course, we know the latter is true. We don't have two books in God's Word that contradict one another. And so there is a consistency between them that we're gonna study on this morning. And this concept about even the demons is eventually going to make sense in illustrating that today. Well, I've hit the remote twice. I guess if you turn it on, it works better. Let's see. Right there, look at that. So let's talk about demons a little bit as we start this morning. There is clearly one New Testament character, one Bible character, we should say, that is identified as the devil. There's one singular character that we think of as Satan. But there is a plurality of beings that are called devils or demons, depending on which translation you're looking at. We're going to start actually in the book of Luke in chapter 11. So if you have your Bibles handy, we'll get to James in a moment. We'll start, though, looking in Luke chapter 11 this morning. These devils or demons are evil spirits. They're something similar to angels in a way, and yet they're polar opposites in terms of the angels' goodness and helpfulness toward mankind, where the demons really seem to be working totally against humankind. I'm in Luke chapter 11 and in verse 14. Luke chapter 11 and in verse 14. Jesus was casting out a demon that was mute, and when the demon had gone out, the mute man spoke, and the people marveled. But some of them said, "He cast out demons by Beelzebul, the prince of demons," while others, to test him, kept seeking from him a sign from heaven. But he, knowing their thoughts, said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and the divided household falls. And if Satan also is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? For you say that I cast out demons by Beelzebul. If I cast out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore they will be your judges. But if it is by the finger of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are safe. But when one stronger than he attacks him and overcomes him, he takes away his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoil. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters." The angels are portrayed as being ministering servants of God, but the demons are on the side of the devil. They're on the other side altogether. They're engaged with the devil in executing acts of mischief in the New Testament age upon those who would be saved. John, in his gospel, reports that Jesus was oftentimes accused of having a demon because the things that he was saying were not things that the Pharisees and other religious leaders in his age really wanted to hear. John the Baptizer was also accused of having a demon because his doctrine was not in accordance with what they were wanted to be taught. Very little is told to us about the origin or the abode of demons, save that they must have been created by God because everything was created by God. They must have been created with free will because every conscious being has choice in God's economy, but also that they must have gone astray to the devil's side at some point in their existence, and that they abide close enough to man, at least in New Testament times, to trouble him very severely. In a very figurative passage, Jesus refers to their abode as being in deserted and desolate places. Turn with me over to Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 12. Matthew 12 and 38, Jesus talks about them there. Matthew 12 and 38, some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him, saying, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But he answered them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 nights and 3 days in the belly of the great fish, so will be the Son of Man 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah. Behold, something greater than Jonah is here. The queen of the south will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. Behold, something greater than Solomon is here. When the unclean spirit has gone out of a person, it passes through waterless places seeking rest and finds none. Then it says, 'I will return to my house from which I came.' And when it comes, it finds the house empty, swept and put in order. Then it goes and brings with it 7 other spirits, more evil than itself, and they enter and dwell there. And the last state of that person is worse than the first. So also it will be with this evil generation." There's another confrontation in the Gospels with Jesus that the demons have. In Luke chapter 8, and they actually beg Jesus to send them, to banish them in some abyss. In Luke chapter 8, there is that desire on the demon's part to be sent to a very dark and deserted place where they might exist by punishment. Writing much later, I'm going to turn to Ephesians chapter 2. The Apostle Paul traces the demons to the atmosphere. Ephesians, the second chapter. It says that while they're there, they had influence over human beings, even if they were not able to possess them at that point. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1, Paul writes, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desire of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind." There's more. 7 demons had dwelt in Mary Magdalene as well that were cast out. And so we see the demons and a little bit about their existence and really about their own chosen purpose in their existence as well. I'm going to go back to Matthew 8. We've kind of jumped around a lot today, but I'm going to return to Matthew chapter 8 and verse 14. In the New Testament, specifically during the time of the ministry of Christ, we find really the only point at which demonic activity is so heightened that these demons were said to be able to possess the bodies of people and compel them to commit very antisocial, very self-destructive behavior. It's strange that it seems to pop up all of a sudden, and it really seems to wane after the time of Christ. It might be that this just occurred to give Jesus an opportunity to demonstrate the fact that he had power over them. Matthew 8 is where I am, verse 14. Jesus goes into the house of Peter and saw Peter's mother-in-law lying sick with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she rose and began to serve him. That evening they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah: "He took our illnesses and bore our diseases." Casting out demons was one of the chief miracles by which Jesus and his followers worked to establish the validity of the claim that he made to be the Messiah. There was an attempt to prove that Jesus was the Christ by the abilities that he had, the things that he could do. Luke chapter 9, we'll turn to Luke chapter 9. Luke 9, and just in verse 1, he called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. In chapter 10, same gospel, verse 1, "After this, he appointed 72 others," or 70, some translations say, "and sent them out ahead of him, 2 by 2, into every town and place where he himself was about to go." In verse 17, in that same context, those 70 or 72 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." And he said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I've given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." The result of demon possession, as you read about it in the New Testament, included not only misbehavior, but sometimes what we today would describe as medical symptoms, seizures and paroxysms that sometimes seemed as if people were lacking in control over themselves. And they were. Repeatedly, the word that we see applied to this is oppression. That these people, otherwise innocent of what was going on, were being oppressed by these demons and compelled to behave in the way that they were. That word oppression refers to the effect that happened to them before they met Jesus, and he set them free from that. And so from demon possession, we go to that next step in the New Testament, and we see the existence of exorcism. Exorcism continued to be evidence of discipleship, even after his ascension as well. The ability that his followers had to cast out these demons occurred. I'm going to turn to Mark chapter 16. And again, it's for the same purpose of proving that Jesus was the Messiah. Mark 16, now verse 14. Mark 16, 14, afterward he appeared to the 11 surviving apostles as they were reclining at the table, and he rebuked them for their unbelief and hardness of heart because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. These signs will accompany those who believe in my name, the first one in the list. They will cast out demons. So that is evidence again that these apostles, these followers, really were sent by Christ. Without that power, though, exorcism always seemed to fall flat. I'll read you one more thing, or read with you one more thing in Acts, the 16th chapter to begin with, Acts 16. Sometimes there were efforts to cast out these demons that were unsuccessful. Acts 16, verse 16. Luke writes, as we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by fortune telling. She followed Paul and us, crying out, these men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation. And this she kept doing for many days. Paul, having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And it came out that very hour. That was successful. In chapter 19, verse 11. Chapter 19, verse 11, again, success is here. And God was doing extraordinary, in verse 11 of Acts 19, God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul proclaims. Seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. But the evil spirit answered them, Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize, but who are you? The man in whom was the evil spirit leapt on them, mastered all of them, and overpowered them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. This became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, and fear fell upon them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was extolled. So successful when empowered by God, but a failure when it was not given by that power. The demons were associated with paganism, but it was really the kind of idolatry that was also troubling Israel in Old Testament times. And it was a form of idolatry and paganism that was still lingering among Gentiles in the first century. The Jews had dealt with it before the coming of Jesus, but the Gentiles were still practicing a lot of that. I'm going to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We were there during Bible class a little bit this morning. We're actually going to pick up after that point. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 15. And Paul writes here, I speak as to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation of the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body. For we all partake of the one bread. Consider the people of Israel. Are not those who eat the sacrifices participants in the altar? What do I imply then? That food offered to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they offer to demons and not to God. I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Shall we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than He? So there's a connection there between these devils and demons and idols and all of that worship that was evil as well. Demons are real members of the spirit world. But their ability to possess and to trouble humans was severely curtailed as the gospel advanced throughout the world. Especially once miraculous powers also disappeared in the shadow of the New Testament being completed. They continue to encourage destructive errors. The Bible tells us even more than that. The Bible tells us as well that the Spirit expressly says that in later times some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons. So if anything in this age, we don't see people being possessed by demons, and we don't see the trouble being caused by them in quite the same physical ways that we saw in the first century. But what we do see are false teachings. Errors that are believed by people that cause just as much mischief among men today. The modern day activity of demons is a matter of great conjecture and popular fascination. We have books about it, we have movies, we even have religions that are based in evil, in devils and demons. Since the age of miracles has passed with the arrival of the perfect law of liberty of the New Testament, it's reasonable for us to conclude that demon possession has passed as well. Man would have no recourse to deal with it. No one could exorcise a demon because nobody has those miraculous abilities today. That doesn't mean the demons are extinct. I wish they were. It doesn't mean that they're imaginary. I don't think that they are. But what it does mean is that believers don't have to fear them today in the way that Mary Magdalene had to fear demons in her house. We all have victory by faith over those things, and God doesn't allow that power to be exercised in the way that existed in the first century when Jesus and the apostles were on the earth. And so, with a little bit about demons behind this, I'm going to go back now and try to trace our way to this idea of the fact that demons believe in God and what they do about that. Because one more thing we have to understand about them is that they not only believe in God, they know that Jesus Christ is His Son. And they know that without any doubt, without any reservation, without any skepticism. Among believers today, oftentimes there are those things. We go through periods, of doubt. We sometimes find people believe in God, but with reservation. They believe in Him up to a point. And we find many, many people who are skeptics about the existence of God or the reality of Jesus Christ. Demons, instead, are simply too given over to evil to do anything productive or redemptive about the belief that they have. And so James tells us in his letter that the demons believe, and in the English Standard Version in James chapter 2, it says that the demons believe and they shudder or tremble in older translations. That idea, that word, is a word that means in the Greek to be struck with extreme fear, to be horrified. That hasn't happened to me too many times in my life that I have shuddered, that I have been so afraid. It has happened. There have been times when I've been driving and something happens and it's very sudden and it's almost an accident. I've had real accidents and I didn't shudder because I was hurt too bad. But the accidents that I missed, sometimes that's what the result is. I shudder. I'm scared. I'm horrified by what happened. There have been other times that I've been so afraid of something that that's resulted. It's when you get the goosebumps and the hair stands up on your arms and the back of your neck, and you are really terrified by what's in front of you. The demons believe, and that's what they do. They shudder. It's a Greek word that you probably haven't heard of. It's pronounced frisso. Kind of a weird word. It's actually a French word as well. And we borrowed it into English also. It's spelled differently in the English and the French than it is there in our transliterated Greek. But Thayer in his lexicon says, shudder comes from the Greek word frisso, meaning literally to bristle, stiff and stand up as in the hair standing up straight on your head or neck from something frightful. That's the terror. A few years ago, my family and I went on a vacation to Roswell, Georgia. Now, that sounds weird. it wasn't to Roswell, Georgia. We went canoeing or kayaking in North Carolina, ended up in Georgia in a little town called Roswell that I'm sure nobody picks out to visit on purpose. But while there, there was a ghost tour. And so that's something we did one evening. We went on this ghost tour. And we walk around, and they try to get you kind of, they try to get your imagination working. And so maybe that you'll see things or imagine things. And there's always somebody on a ghost tour is going to say, oh, I saw something in that window. And you're going to think, maybe I saw something too. It happens. It's like the Ouija board. It's the power of suggestion. We walked around for a couple of hours, and we got to the last house on that tour. And I stood in the yard outside of that house, and it was scary. It was a spooky house. I don't believe in the existence of ghosts, and I don't believe that there was any danger in going in that house, but there was no chance in the world I was going in that house. They could have said, all right, folks, we're going to take a tour of this house, and I would have said, nice seeing you. Where's my car? There's no way. That was the spookiest place I have ever seen in person. And I stood there, and the hair was standing up on the back of my neck. Something frightful. Now, the weird thing about that house is that about 2 years later, it burned down. And I'm actually pretty grateful, because if I ever go back to Roswell, Georgia, I know there's one less thing I've got to be afraid of. But that's the kind of thing. If you've been in that situation where it is just terrifying, that's what Thayer is saying the demons do when they think about the existence of God. Albert Barnes, in his commentary, added, very similar, but to bristle, to stand on end as the hair does in a fright, then to shudder or quake with fear. I think of Don Knotts and the Ghost of Mr. Chicken. I'm sure some of you are familiar with that movie, and others of you are going, who's Don Knotts? I apologize for that. But that's the quaking with fear. Scared so badly that you're shaking. The demons don't just know about God. James says they also know that he's a consuming fire, and it is terrifying to them, but they are who they are, and they're not going to do anything about it. So you see, this morning, you are who you are. But the question remains, what are you going to do about it? The demons believe, they tremble, but the Bible says that they're damned anyway. The first impulse that I think the reader has as he looks at James chapter 2 is to wonder how these spiritual creatures could believe and still be disobedient. And I might wonder that myself, except that I know of hundreds, if not thousands, of people on this earth who believe in God, but who are still disobedient. How is it difficult for demons to believe and be disobedient? It's as easy as it is for humans to do it. And a lot of people do it. The difference is that among the demons, there aren't any sincere doubters like there are among human beings. There aren't any apathetic skeptics who just really aren't taking the time to look into the subject. They know there's a God. For sure. And the demons, I guess, have deeper insight into the affairs of the spiritual plane, such as it is, than we do. And they are immune to atheism and yet disobedient. Humans contract, though, an equally destructive complacency by which they sometimes likewise believe in God as much as the demons do. But they don't tremble. Well, that's a little scary that the faith of demons might be deeper than the faith that I have. Look at 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. 2 Peter 2 and verse 1, the writer says, false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. Many will follow their sensuality, and because of them the way of truth will be blasphemed. In verse 10 of that same chapter, in verse 10, in the middle, bold and willful, it says, they do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious ones. And many people are like that. Here are false teachers who are exactly that way. So they have the same lack of conviction that brings them to obedience. We're going to go back to James 2. We've only really hinted at it so far. James 2, the point that James was illustrating when he made that comment about the demons that we're finally going to read is really a contrast between two kinds of faith. One kind of faith is a saving faith. It's a faith that I think everybody in this house this morning hopes that he or she possesses. The other kind of faith is a damning faith. And that's a phrase you probably haven't heard before and maybe doesn't make a lot of sense. I hope it does in a few minutes. It is a faith that really is not that uncommon. It's a faith that accepts the facts but rejects the application. Does that sound familiar? It's a faith that talks the talk but doesn't walk the walk. I know that sounds familiar. James says in verse 14 of chapter 2, "What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, 'You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.' You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder." One of the strongest statements in the entire New Testament. In verse 13, before our reading this morning, I think is the balance of chapter 2. And that's the phrase, "Mercy triumphs over judgment." Mercy affords the transgressor and the stumbler the forgiveness that's necessary to get back up again and trust God enough to continue the march toward eternity. James says God has this kind of mercy that he looks upon you, and when you fall, he wants you to get back up and he wants you to try again. And what James says is that you need to be like that. You need to treat people that way, that you can lift them back up and encourage them to start walking again. Mercy gives a person a second chance. The kind of faith that saves matches the kind of human mercy that does more than talk about relieving people who are in need. It actually does something to that end. It doesn't have a sentiment of, "I hope it gets better for you. Now please get out of my way." It's the kind of faith that says, "I'm going to help it get better for you. I'm here for you." Faith, like talk, by itself is dead. Whenever there's a tragedy in this country, there's a discussion about thoughts and prayers for the people who are suffering. In El Paso, in Sutherland Springs, in Boston, wherever there's a tragedy, and there's a tragedy everywhere these days eventually, it's thoughts and prayers. And then there's another section of people who say thoughts and prayers are pointless and meaningless. They are usually atheists, by the way, who say those things. The reality, though, is somewhere in between. Thoughts and prayers without action is pretty hopeless. If you are praying to God to do something you are unwilling to participate in, though you have the ability, it's pretty pointless. And it's the exact kind of damning faith we're talking about that the demons have. It's exactly the same. Mercy triumphs over judgment. The faith of the demons is unproductive, as is the faith of any person who's not stirred out of a seat of complacency to obey the gospel or to return to a faithful lifestyle, what he's been chasing. Some people, like the demons, they both believe and they tremble, but they're still not motivated to make changes. They believe in God and they're scared, and some will even say that I'm going to hell when I die, and I can't believe that they say that and don't do anything about it. And yet some people do lots of unhealthy things that they're sure is going to give them cancer or something else, and yet they don't stop it. So why are we surprised? I'm going to turn back to the book of Acts in chapter 24. Acts chapter 24 and verse 22. Acts 24 and 22. Here we meet a man named Felix, having a rather accurate knowledge of the way, put them off, saying, "When Lysias the tribune comes down, I'll decide your case." Then he gave orders to the centurion that he should be kept in custody, but have some liberty, that none of his friends should be prevented from attending to his needs. But after some days, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, and he sent for Paul and heard him speak about faith in Christ Jesus. And as Paul reasoned about righteousness and self-control and the coming judgment, Felix was alarmed. Might he be shuddering, trembling? was alarmed and said, "Go away for the present. When I get an opportunity, I'll summon you." At the same time, he hoped that that money would be given him by Paul. So he sent for him often and conversed with him. When 2 years had elapsed, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus, and that was the end of that. He's alarmed, he's shuddering, he's trembling. He doesn't do anything about it. If faith alone saved, the demons would be golden, right? They believe. But they're not objects of grace or mercy as long as they reject God's purpose for creation. The same is true for any of us who hear and believe, but either we don't tremble or we tremble to no avail. We tremble and don't do anything about it. Sorry, I keep falling behind you. I keep getting involved in my own thoughts and forgetting where I am. In Matthew 5, Jesus said, "I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." He's talking to believers. The righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees was self-serving, hypocritical, judgmental, legalistic, short-sighted, and ineffective. Pharisees and the lawyers rejected the purpose of God for themselves, not having been baptized. James says you got to do better than that, and so does Jesus. The point is that baptism alone is no more effective than faith alone or grace that is unanswered. Philippians, the second chapter, we're almost finished. Philippians, the second chapter, verse 12. Paul writes, Philippians 2 and 12, "Therefore, my beloved, as you always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and what?" There it is again, trembling. "For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Even the demons believe and tremble, but their incomplete faith is not enough to acquaint them with mercy and salvation. The question is, does your faith exceed? Is your righteousness more than the scribes and Pharisees? Not your perfection, because I'm not interested in that because you don't have any. God is not interested in your perfection because you don't have any. But is your righteousness more than that? Is your effort more than the scribes and Pharisees? Is your sincerity better than theirs? Is your fruitfulness going to be more than theirs? We want to extend the invitation of Jesus Christ to you this morning. Be baptized, as we've discussed even today, for the forgiveness of your sins. Also, if this morning you as a believer tremble because your eternal fate is in doubt in your own mind, could we invite you this morning likewise to make something right with God? If you need to respond to the gospel call, would you come as we stand and sing this song of invitation?